Southern Voices presents an unabridged recording of Fair and Tender Ladies by Lee Smith, narrated by Kate Forbes. Southern Voices is an imprint of Recorded Books, celebrating the rich heritage and distinct characteristics of Southern writers. This book is copyrighted 1988 by Lee Smith. This recording is copyrighted 2004 by Recorded Books. The author opens with the poem Weep Willow from the collection Wildwood Flower by Catherine Stripling Byer. At night she watched the road and sang. I'd sigh and settle on the floor beside her. One song led to one more song. Some unquiet grave, a bed of stone, the ship that spun round three times ere it sank, near 90 verses full of grief. She sang sad all night long, and smiled as if she dared me shed a tear. Sweet Lizzie Creek swung low along the rocks, and dried beans rattled in the wind. Sometimes her black dog howled at fox or bear, but she'd not stop. No, not for God himself, not even if he rode astride a fine white horse and bore the crown of glory in his hands. The dark was all she had, and sometimes moonlight on the ceaseless water. Fill my cup, she'd say, and sip May moonshine, till her voice came back as strong as bullfrogs in the sally grass. You whippoorwills keep silent. And you lonesome owls, go haunt another woman's darkest hours. Clear, clear back, I hear her singing me to sleep. Come down, she trolls, come down among the willow shade and weep, you fair and tender ladies, left to lie alone. The sheets so cold, the nights so long. And now, Fair and Tender Ladies.
Part 1. Letters from Sugar Fork. My dear Hanukkah, your name is not much common here. I think it is so pretty, too. I say it now and again. It tastes sweet in my mouth like honey or cane, or how I picture the fauched-on candy from Mrs. Brown's book about France, candy which mimics roses. Have you seed any such as this? I have not. I have seed them in her red book, that is all. My teacher is called Mrs. Brown. She is from far away also. She has lived in the city of St. Louis once, with buggies and streetlights. I know all about it now. And I know all how you live, too. We have seen the pictures. I cannot feature it all so flat there, with flat water so brightly blue, and never a mountain nor nary a cloud in the sky. You are lower than the sea, so that once a boy has had to stick his finger in the wall to hold back the water. This is scary to me. I have ne'er seed the ocean, nor has anyone I know seed it, although Daddy has been to the city, too. He did not like it with bad water and no air and no mountains like Bethel Mountain yonder. Daddy says he needs a mountain to rest his eyes against. But in the book, I have seed those fields of flowers, tulips. We think you have wooden shoes. Mama makes all of our clothes. We have store-bought shoes, though. They are black. They have copper on the toes so as not to wear out very fast. I disgust them and wish for wooden shoes and a lace cap like yourn and such pretty long white stockings. You look like a little queen. I know it is not you in the book, but I think it is you. I hope you will be my pen friend. My mama had also a white dress with lace as a girl. I have seen the picture. She stands by the door. It is a fancy door of a house in a town I know is Rich Valley, where she has grown up, and there is her big father smiling, holding her hand. But now a hardness has come up between them. He has a black suit and a black mustache and a gold watch chain hanging down in the picture. He is rich. His name is Mr. Castle, and we do not know him at all. He is smiling, but he is mean. My mama Maud was then 15. Her mama had died of her lungs in the year 1886, so that Maud was the light of her daddy's life and the only joy of his heart. Then my daddy come to Rich Valley, and she took up with him, and her and him set to walking out together of an evening like you do. Mr. Castle said, "No, I forbid it. He has no prospects," and said he would send my mama to her mother's sister in Memphis, Tennessee, where my mama never had been or even heard tell of, to learn her some sense and how to act like a lady at last. Instead, my mama packed up her own mama's silver brush and comb, which was all she took, and lit out in the dead of night for Sugar Fork with my daddy, John Arthur Rowe. He is a red-headed man. He had been over there in Rich Valley with his brother, trading mules. My mama and him rode double, astride on Daddy's horse, Lightning. She was glad to leave, she said, and never looked back nor cared for a thing but my daddy. They carried a pine knot that burned in the night to show them the way. They passed through Squeezed Betsy in the Pound Gap. It was so black at night, the rocky cliffs is so high, they near about black out the moon. And then you come up on Bethel Mountain, which is high and lonesome, and a hoot owl screeched out in the night. It liked to have scared my mama to death. She was a town girl. She liked to have plumb lost heart then and there, Daddy says. He says the pine knot was burning yaller, and you could see little critter's eyes all shining yaller in the light from the edge of the woods. They is still bears and catamounts up on Bethel Mountain to this day. Well, Mom and Daddy come on to Slate Creek and followed it down to Home Creek, where they forded it at the grist mill, and Mama got down in the dark and wetted her face with the water. She said her face was burning as hot as fire. She was all a-tremble from what she had done. And they never knowed at that time if Mr. Castle would have sent a posse out after them or not. My daddy, a bachelor, was considerable older than her. Mama said she seed her face in the still black pool by the pine knot's yaller light, and she looked so wild she could not have said who she was. She could not have called her own name. But she said that the water in Home Creek was so cool and tasted the sweetest of any she ever had. And Daddy kissed her. And they got up again on Lightning, though Mama was so sore by then that she liked to have died. She said she was down in the back afterwards for days and days. So they rode on alongside Home Creek, and by then it was getting light. On the prettiest path you have ever seed, it is still right here. It runs through sprucey pines and he-balsams and past three little old waterfalls. When you get to that third one, you start looking out for them two big cedar trees, and you leave Home Creek right there where Sugar Fork comes into it, and follow Sugar Fork up and up. You will ford it twice. It's the loudest and singingest little old creek you ever dreamed of. And directly, when you can't go no further, you'll be here. Here in my daddy's house, which was his daddy's house afore him, way up here on Blue Star Mountain. And it ain't nobody up here but us'ns. Daddy had lived up here farming all by himself since his own daddy died of his heart, and his mama died of the bloody flux, and his sister had married and gone off, and his brother Revel had took to hellin' around so. Sometimes Daddy would go down the mountain somewhere and help Revel with his business, which is mules. But then he would come back up here directly, Daddy would. He don't love no place in the world, he says, like he loves Sugar Fork. Well, it was getting on for daybreak when my daddy and my mama come riding up there plumb wore out, and Lightning so puny he is going on dead. He never was the same horse after that night, Daddy said. You can see for why. Uncle Revel wanted to trade him after he got so puny, but Mama said no, and she fed him out of her own hand and would not let nobody ride him but her until the day he died, which was not long in coming. That ride had used him teetotally up. The sun come peeping up then over the top of Hell Mountain like a white-hot fiery ball rising up from the fog that always hangs on the mountaintop of an evening. It will burn off in the day. Mama looked around. She saw Sugar Fork sparkle in the sun like a lady's diamond necklace. She saw Pilgrim Knob rise up directly behind the house and Blue Star Mountain beyond. They call it that because of how blue it looks from down below, along Home Creek and Davis Branch. Why, you can see Blue Star Mountain clear from Majestic on a pretty day. And you can see the Conaways and the Rillettes and the Foxes' cabins coming up Home Creek from the schoolhouse like her and Daddy had done that morning. Now, you can see all them neighbor people's houses fine, but you can't see ourn, nor get to it neither, without wanting to. You are not going to happen upon us, is what I mean. And Blue Star Mountain don't seem so blue, neither, when you're up here. But it is the prettiest place in the world. And so my mama looked all around, and she seed all of that. She seed the shining waters of Sugar Fork go leaping off down the mountain into the laurel slick, and she seed that this is a good big double cabin here, with a breezeway in between, where it is fine to set and look out and do your piecework. And she seed the snowball bush in the yard, and the rosy bush here by the porch, all covered with pink flowers. It was June. And Mama looked up in the sky, she said, and she seed a hawk gliding circles around and around without never flapping his wings. Again, that big blue sky. She said that hawk made three circles in the sky, and then Daddy turned to her, real formal-like, and cleared his throat, and said, "Maud, it is what I have to give you. It is all I have." But she knowed this. She had knowed it all along. "It will do, John," is what she said. Then she busted out laughing, and my daddy picked her up and carried her in the house, which is where I live today, in Virginia, in the United States of America. But you must put Majestic Virginia, USA, and many stamps on the outside of your letter, Mrs. Brown said, or it will not come here. Now I am glad I have set this all down, for I can see my mama and daddy as young and laughing. This is not how they are today. For I have to say they did not live happily ever after, as in Mrs. Brown's book. I reckon that might even have been the lastest time my daddy ever lifted her up, or lifted ary anything else heavy, because before long a weakness was to come upon him from the heart. Now this is Daddy's bad heart, which he has to this day. He is the disablest one up here right now. You can hear his bad heart for yourself if you come over and put your ear up against his chest. It goes, dum-dum, dum-dum. Like our banty rooster that goes, cuckoo, cuckoo, of a morning on Pilgrim Knob. You can hear Daddy's bad heart just thumping away irregular in his chest. He is little now, too. Hardly no meat at all on his bones, but his hair is still thick and red, and his eyes are so blue and just as lively as Sugar Fork. He will still tell a story. He is little, though, like a brownie in Mrs. Brown's McGuffey reader. Do you have a reader? Do you like to read? I love it better than anything, and mostly poems such as Thanatopsies and The Little Toy Soldier is Covered with Dust, but sturdy and staunch he stands. And the highwayman came riding up to the old inn door. I love that one the bestest. Mr. Brown is a foreign preacher from the north, but does not preach. He is the husband of Mrs. Brown, my teacher. He says to her, "What is your substance? Whereof are you made?" And other poems. He carries bunches of flowers up from the creek for her, and one time, it was about a month ago, he brung them right into the schoolhouse and give them to her with a funny little bow like a prince. You ought to have seed him. We was all right there when he done it. Her cheeks turned as red as an apple. I would have had a fit if it was me. For I take an interest in her and Mr. Brown, and in what I have told you, the story of my mama and daddy. I take an interest in love because I want to be in love one day and write poems about it. Do you? But I do not want to have a lot of babies, though, and get titties as big as the moon. So it is hard to think what to do. My mama was young and so pretty when she come riding up Sugar Fork. But she does not look pretty now. She looks awful. Like her face is hainted. She has had too much on her. Too much to contend with, she says. So next, I will write you about my life. It is what Mrs. Brown said to do. I want to be a writer. It is what I love the bestest in this world. Mrs. Brown says I have a true talent, she thinks. She gives me books to read, but Mama gets pitched off if and I read too much. I have to help out, and I will just fill my head with notions, Mama says. It will do me no good in the end. My hair is long and yaller red. It comes down to my waist, and Sylvanie helps me to wash it. We spread it over a chair back to lift it to dry in front of the fire. Mama come in last night when we was all drying our hair, Sylvanie and Beulah and me and Ethel. Sylvanie's hair is real long and curly and well nigh white, and Ethel's is real light yaller, and Beulah's hair is as red as that sour gum tree right now up on Pilgrim's Knob. She takes after Daddy the mostest. Mama just set to staring with her eyes as big as a plate, and then she commences to weeping out loud. "Now, Maud, what's the matter?" Daddy said to her from his pallet up next to the fire. We keep him up there so close, but he can't hardly get warm, even though it is not but October, and we ain't yet had a killing frost. "Whatever's the matter now, Maud?" Daddy said. "These girls is all so pretty," she said. "They'd be better off ugly. These girls is all so pretty they'd be better off dead." "Hush now, Maud. You just hush. She don't mean it, girls. She's just wore out," Daddy said to us. "She is all wrought up. Don't pay her no mind now, girls," Daddy said. He is there on his pallet, pulled up by the fire. We are all in a row with our hair spreaded out on the chair backs to dry. So this is the members of my family, I will tell you, as Mrs. Brown said. And of my chores and our culture, too. I would like to see your face. I feature your face as white as ice, and your eyes so blue, like the Ice Queen, but smiling with cherry red lips. I know you have windmills and big pieted black and white cows in the flat green fields. Well, we have got a cow, too. Her name is Bessie, but she is close to give out at this time. We grow near about all we eat, and mostly the corn, which will work you to death. So I can't go to school sometimes in the spring when we plant it, or later on you have got to get out there and hoe it to beat the band, and the side of Blue Star Mountain is so steep you've got to hill it good, or it won't grow at all. And we used to grow us a patch of cane, too, and then we would make molasses. Folks would come from all around and help, but we have not got no cane this year as Daddy is poorly. He has to lay down. And we grow cabbages and sweet taters and white taters both and shucky beans, and we have got some apple trees too. But Bess, as I said, is sick. This is fidgeting Mama to death what to do, for the twins is so little yet. We need the milk, for Danny is always weak. They is chickens and turkeys grabbling out in the woods and guinea hens up by the house. They say, "Pot rack, pot rack." I hate it when Mama kills them. You don't want to get you a pet hen, you will be sorry. Nor a pet pig neither, like Lizzie that was mine. But we raise what we need. We don't go to the store for nothing but coffee and shoes and nails and to get the mail. We do not get any mail much, but sometimes a letter from Daddy's sister in Welch or Mama's friend Geneva Hunt from childhood or a pattern Mama sent all for. Mama can sew anything. She could sew so pretty if she had the time. Beulah and Ethel sews, too, now. The store is at Majestic. It is the P.O., too. This is where Mrs. Brown will take my letter to you. Then Bill Waldrop will put it in his saddlebag and carry it over the mountain. A ship will carry it over the sea. Does this seem magical to you? It seems so to me. I wish you could see Stony Branham's store at Majestic. They is a wood stove at the back, where all the men gathers round and spits tobacco and waits for Bill Waldrop to come and lays bets on what time he will get there. They talk and talk about who has seed a bear, or who is laying up in the bed sick, or who has been bit by a snake, or where lightning has struck last, or they will tell a tale. And the women folks that is in there will be looking at thread or maybe some flowered piecey goods. Stony Branham sends tobacco back to Daddy, who coughs so deep now it is just like thunder over Hell Mountain when he coughs now. It is really terrible. There is more wrong with him now than his heart. "Do you reckon John Arthur will make it through the winter?" Stony said to Granny Rowe. "It was a week ago Monday. I heard him myself. Anybody could have heard him that had ears." Which means Sylvany, who got all wrought up something awful, she run out back of Stony Branham's store and cried. She knows a lot more than you think. I will tell you of my family now, and she will be first. I love Sylvany the bestest, you see. Sylvany is so pretty. She is the sweetest, all silver-haired, like she was fotched up on the moon. She takes after a princess in a story, Sylvany does. Her and my brother Babe was twins, which runs in the family. Sylvany is 5 years older than me. But something is wrong with Sylvany. She had brain fever as a baby. Now she will never be right in the head. It don't matter, she's so sweet, but she scares easy. Sometimes she will put her apron up over her head and start in crying. Another time she will get to laughing, and she can't stop. You have to pour a gourd full of water down over her face. Mama says she run a fever for days and days. It has burned out a part of her brain. So Sylvany don't go to school to Mrs. Brown. But you can't tell it just to see her. She is the prettiest thing. So Sylvany is bigger and older than me. But it is like we are the same sometimes. It is like we are one. We have slept in the same bed all of our lives and done everything as one. I am smart, though. I go to school when I can and try to better myself and teach Sylvany, but she can't learn. Lord, me and her have had some fun, though, just us'ns. We get a piece of tin sometimes and some rocks and sneak off and build us a little stove right out in the woods and gather up sticks and make us a little cook fire under the tin. Then we have got a little stove. Then I will take out the meal I have stole from the chest on the porch and wound up in my skirt and get some water from Sugar Fork, and we will make us some little pancakes and have us a play party right there in the woods by the creek in our secret place. We put Black Eyed Susan's and Queen Anne's lace in our hair. We have party names, too. I am the Princess Lucia. She is the Princess Melissa Clarissa, and Beulah used to play too sometimes. She was Miss Margaret White. Who knows where she got that name? But Beulah will not play no more. She is courting Curtis Bostick from Poor Bottom. He rides up here on his listed horse and takes her walking. I do not know what they will do when it gets cold and they cannot go walking, as we are so many here in the house, and Curtis Bostick don't know how to court good inside a house. Beulah says he just sits like a bump on a log. He is not a bit good at sweethearting, to do it as much as he does. Anyway, now we do not have Miss Margaret White, so we have made up a Miss France, who wears a big pink hat and sticks out her finger and laughs. La la la? I cannot tell if Sylvany knows that Miss France is made up or not. Well, Ethel is only 9, but she will not play party. When I say, I have some scrumptious cake, she says it is only pone. And when I say, hear the lovely music, Miss Ethel, it is violins. She says, my name is nothing but Ethel, just plain Ethel, and that is birds. Ethel will not even play town, but Victor will watch sometimes, and Garney will preach. What you do is make you some little houses out in sticks, and you can chink up your logs with mud if you wish to. and you can have some rocks for furniture, all covered over with moss that you find by the creek where it gets so little and bouncy starting up Pilgrim Knob. Now this will be your fancy furniture. That is your bed and chairs and all, and you will make corn cob people. You can have pine cones for pigs and a cow and the chicks in the yard. And your own people can come to and fro. They can go courting and have a baby and die or get saved or whatever you want to happen. One time me and Victor, this is my elder brother, he won't play no more neither. One time me and Victor stole us some thread and hitched up some big old bugs and made us horses named Buck and Barry. And if you want little old Garney to play, you have got to let him preach a funeral and sing. Been a long time traveling here below. Been a long time traveling here below. Been a long time traveling from my home to lay this body down. But then you will have to pour water on Sylvanie's face. She cries so hard at a funeral. Mama says, stop this. This is awful. And Sylvanie is too old to play. But we sneak off. We have us a time, I guess. What do you all play? Mrs. Brown said I should tell you about our chores, but they are never over. It is so hard on a farm without no mule. We had one, but it died a year ago, come April, I think it was. And Daddy has had a big falling out with Revel now, so we can't get no more mules from him. Ain't none of us set eyes on Revel for over a year. So we go down on Home Creek and get the loan of one from the Rolettes. Folks is real nice. They know Daddy is sick. So Victor, he runs the farm, and Mama the bestest they can, and I will get up in the morning before full light and milk Bessie, and Beulah, she will start in cooking, and Ethel will dress the young'uns, and Sylvanie looks for eggs. And then I will bring up the milk and strain it, and put it in the churn, and wrench out the strainer and things, and hang them up, and later on I will have to churn or go out and hoe the corn and such as that. It is always something to do on a farm. The next leastest has to watch out for the leastest ones, and I love to do that. I used to take Garney and Ethel up under the rocky cliffs by the cornfield to watch them while everybody was working. It's fun in there. You can go way back and keep so cool. One time we was up there, and I seed a rattlesnake all quilled up and singing to beat the band. I had to snatch up Ethel. She thought it was a play pretty. Babe killed it with a hoe. He loves to kill things, Babe does. I am so glad he is gone from here now. I hope he is gone for good. This is my eldest brother, named Clarence Wayne, but called Babe. He is mean as a snake himself. He works for Frank Ritter Lumber Company now in Bone Valley, we think. He don't send us hardly a thing. When we was all real little, I recall Daddy showing us how to make frog houses out in the yard. This is where you put your bare foot down in the dirt and push up the dirt all around it, and then you take out your foot, and you have got you a house. You would leave them there of a summer night for the frogs to come. But Babe used to stomp them down. They say he takes after my daddy's brother, Revel Rowe, and this is so. But Revel is funny, too, and a handsome man, even if he is sorry, as they say. I will stop now and fold up this letter, which I have writ as neat and as small as possible. It has took days and days. I hope you will enjoy to read it and be my pen friend always. I will carry this letter down to Mrs. Brown when next I go. I have not been to school for a long time now, nor has any one of us, as my daddy is not doing any good at all, nor is Danny, and it is coming on for winter at this time. We have to pull the fodder now and get it down off in the mountain on the wood sled. This is very hard without no mule. We have all helped to do this chore. I wonder very much what your chores are, and do you grow very tired also? And are you afeard sometimes of things you cannot put a name to, as I am? Sometimes I'm afeard so, and I could not tell you for why. It is like a fire in my heart when my daddy coughs so loud, or Mama sets her face agin us and will not speak. and I look at Sylvanie, who smiles with a light in her eyes that scares me, for she does not understand. So I will love to have a letter from you. I hope your family is gaily. I remain your devoted pen friend, I am hoping. Ivy Rowe. Dear Mrs. Brown, Victor says he will bring this letter to you. He will come by on his way to Majestic, where he is going to see old Doc Trout to try and get some medicine for Daddy, who is not doing good at all. Daddy is cold all the time, and his face is so dreamy, it seems. We keep that fire just roaring. We are like to burn down the house, Mama says, but it does him no good. He eats scarcely a bite these days, and looks so little, like there is nothing in the bed at all. We have got him under the rising star quilt that Granny Rowe made and given us. We have got him right up by the fire, too. It does no good. So you can see, I cannot come to school now, and for why. I am so thankful for all the writing paper you have sent to me, and for the poems of Eugene Field. I read them out loud to my daddy. This is all that will bring a smile. He loves to hear of the sugar plum tree in the garden of Shut-Eye Town. My bestest is Winkin', Blinkin', and Nod one night sailed off in a wooden shoe, sailed on a river of crystal light into a sea of dew. But, Mrs. Brown, this poem makes me so sad, too, because of the wooden shoe. I have wanted a pen friend always ever since I learned of them, and I do not understand what you mean that my letter is too long and not appropriate. I did not know you would read my letter, either. So I have written another letter to send to Miss Heineke Van Felt. I will send it to you also by Victor. It is very short. Granny Rowe has come to help us. She chews tobacco and spits in the fire. Granny Rowe is my auntie, I think, not my granny, really. Granny Rowe has give Daddy a potion. It don't do no good. He has vomited yaller instead. Mama has given him whiskey and honey. It's better than nothing, at best, but it makes him dreamy. There's ice in the water of Sugar Fork now. It hangs to the rocks on the side. It shines out so pretty of a morning when the sun comes up. It is cold up here now. We are keeping the young'uns inside, if and we can do it. It is hard to make those twins do ary a thing, though. And Mama is acting so funny sometimes. She sits out in the cold at the back of the house, and once I followed her up Pilgrim Knob. She tried to hold later that she was chasing after chickens, but she was not. She was standing there on that rocky cliff, looking out in the wind, and her hair blowed all around her face, but she never cared. Who knowed what she was thinking? And there was never a chicken in sight. I think of you so, and I think, does she still wear the purple dress and the hat with the feather? And the lady's face so fine on the pretty pin, I think it is a cameo. Another one I love is the little boy blue, but it makes us cry, and mostly Sylvanie. We do not know what is a trundle bed. I hope you are keeping fine. I shall remain forever your devoted, Ivy Rowe. My dear Heineke, I am a girl 12 years old, very pretty. I have very long hair and 8 brothers and sisters, and my mother and my father. He is ill. We live on a farm on the Sugar Fork of Home Creek on Blue Star Mountain. The closest town is Majestic, Virginia. It is so pretty up here, but right now it is so cold. I want to be a famous writer when I grow up. I will write of love. My chores are many, but sometimes we have some fun, too, as when we go hunting chestnuts away up on the mountain beyond Pilgrim Knob, which we done yesterday, Victor taking us. Daddy loved this so, but he can't go no more, as he is sick. We start out walking by the tulip tree and the little rocky cliff there on Pilgrim Knob where the chickens runs, but then we keep right on going following Sugar Fork for a while. You get swallowed up in ivy to where it is just like night, but directly you will come out in the clear. You will be so high then it gives you a stitch in your side. You have to stop then and rest and drink some water from Sugar Fork, which is little up there and runs so gaily. And so you go along the footpath where the trees grow few and the grass is everywhere like a carpet in the spring. But now in winter the grass is all froze and you can feel it crunch down when you step. You can hear it, too. We was having a big time crunching it down. When the sun shined on it, it looked like diamond sticks, a million, million strong. Now this was me and Ethel and Beulah and Sylvanie and Garney. Victor taking us. I am wearing Daddy's old black coat. I resemble a haint. We are laughing and laughing. When we get to the chestnut trees, they is four of them. And Victor says, "Hush now. You hush, Sylvanie. We will play a trick on Garney, who's never been up here before." So we get Garney jumping up and down on the froze grass and crushing it down, and Victor, he runs around behind this great big old rock up there and grabs a holt of the leastest tree, and we walk over there with Garney, not acting like nothing is happening. "Get you some chestnuts, Garney," Ethel says. "Where's the chestnuts?" Garney says. "Don't you know how to get no chestnuts, honey?" Beulah says. "You just start picking them up like this. Look at me. It is all they is to it, honey," Beulah says. So we all bend over and act like we are putting chestnuts in the poke, but Garney can't see no chestnuts. "Where's the chestnuts? Where's the chestnuts?" he axes, pulling on Ethel so hard that he like to have pulled her over. Then Victor, he starts hollering and shaking that leastest chestnut tree real hard, and the chestnuts come falling down all around us like a big hard rain. And Garney, he just stands there. He is so surprised. And then he starts laughing and dancing all around, crunching down on the icy grass. And then we was all doing it and laughing. And then we have to get Sylvanie quiet. Now this is hard. And then we filled our pokes up plumb to the top and started down. We was not but halfway up Blue Star Mountain, but you could feel the wind already. There is a famous endless wind up on the cliff at the tip-top of the mountain. I've never been up there. You roast a chestnut in the fire. They taste so sweet. Victor carried Garney on his shoulders all the way down. I see I have writ so long again. Never mind, I will give this letter to Victor anyway. I have got a scar on my wrist, like a little moon, from one time I cut it when I was cleaning a trout fish. What else? My eyes are blue and my hair is red. I will remain forever, I hope, your devoted pen friend, Ivy Rowe. Dear Mrs. Brown, my daddy, John Arthur Rowe, says, "Thank you very much, but I may not come. We will not be beholden in any way." He says to say that he is better. He is not. I will come to school again another time. Maybe Ethel will come too, and Garney, after the thaw. The Rowlettes will drive us as before. They have a wagon, you know. So we will walk down to Home Creek sometimes and come with them. So please do not let Mr. Brown try to come up here. It is not a good idea at all. Even Victor says, do not come. No, Granny Rowe is not here right now. She has had to go back over on Diamond Fork to get Tennessee, who will run after men if you leave her alone, so Granny Rowe has to watch her. She can't keep her hands off the men. These are Daddy's aunts, is who they are. To answer your question, yes, I will be so happy to play with your niece when she comes to visit. I will be so happy to do so. Victor is going over to Bone Valley now, where Babe works for the Frank Ritter Lumber Company. Victor hopes to find work there, too. He will send us money. He will come back to plant in the spring. So we will be fine. Do not worry, please. And here is your book. Do not let Mr. Brown come here, please, as Daddy says he has not got no use for him or his prayers. To answer your question, my mama sits out in the snow and cries. She says she's a fool for love. What is the name of your niece? We thank you for your kindness. We are fine. I do not know whether you will receive this letter or not, though I remain forever your devoted, Ivy Rowe. Dear Mr. Castle, You do not know me. I am your granddaughter, Ivy Rowe, the daughter of your girl Maud, who left Rich Valley to come to Blue Star Mountain with my daddy, John Arthur Rowe. My daddy is sick now. Mama is not pretty no more, but cries all the time now. I thought you might want to know this. I thought you might want to help out some, if and you knowed it, and send some money to us at the P.O. at Majestic, Virginia. You can send it to me, Ivy Rowe. I am hoping you will send us some money. I am hoping you will get this letter. I will send it to you at Rich Valley, Virginia, by Curtis Bostick. He comes up here courting Beulah, who has not been bleeding for a while now. We do not know if and she will marry Curtis Bostick or not. His mama is pitching a fit again it, so they say. It is one more thing to contend with, Mama says. Beulah says she wouldn't have him on a stick, but she would, I bet, never mind what she says. We have not got hardly a thing up here now but meal and taters and shucky beans. Danny has a rising like a pone on the side of his neck, and Daddy breathes awful. Please, if you are alive now, send us money. Tell no one I am writing you this letter. They would kill me for axing, but I know you are a rich man. I will bet you are a good man, too. I remain your devoted granddaughter, Ivy Rowe. My dear Hanukkah, I hate you. You do not write back, nor be my pen friend. I think you are the ice queen instead. I do not have a pen friend or any friend in the world. I have only Sylvanie, who laughs and laughs, and Beulah, who is mad now all the time, and Ethel, who calls a spade a spade. I know you are so rich with all your lace and those fine big cows. I know you have plenty to eat. I know I am evil, and I wish evil for you, too. Mr. Brown told us one time that God is good, but he is not good or bad, either one. I think it is that he does not care. I hope that the sea will come in the hole in the dike and flood you out and you will drown. I will not send this letter, as I remain your hateful Ivy Rowe. Dear Mrs. Brown, I am writing to thank you for the meal and the flour and coffee and the beans you have sent us. Green Patterson come up here with them. He says Mr. Brown has paid to send them from Stony Branham's store. We are so thankful to have them. Things is better up here now, as I will relate. To answer your question, yes, we did have Christmas. It is different. We do not have a tree here, nor have ever seed one. Oakley Fox said you and Mr. Brown have made a tree and hanged it with play pretties. I would admire to see it so. On December 25th, they is not a thing happening as a rule, but on old Christmas Eve, that is January 5th, this is when Gaynell and Virgie Klein comes over and tell stories all night with Daddy, as they did it when Daddy was young. This is Christmas to us. So to answer your question, on December 25th, there was not a thing happening up here on Sugar Fork, nor even down at Home Creek. But that folks drinks liquor and shoots off their guns, I do not mean us. We have not got no liquor here now, but Ethel and me shot the gun. It was fun. You could hear them bang like thunder up and down the fork and clear down on Home Creek. Ethel and me was out in the snow. I was wearing Daddy's coat and his old black hat. Mama says he will never wear them again. It had froze all the previous night, so when I walked out there, Mrs. Brown, it was so pretty that it like to have took my breath away. Ice just shining on each and every limb of every tree, and icicles thick as your arm hanging down off in the house. It was like I looked out on the whole world, and I could see for miles off down the mountain here. But it was new. The whole world was new, and it was like I was the onliest person that had ever looked upon it, and it was mine. It belonged to me. Now, it is new for me to feel this, as I have not had hardly ever a thing of my own. It is hand-me-downs and pitching in and sharing everything up here on Sugar Fork. There is so many of us up here, as you know. But I looked out over all them hills, and the land was sloped so different from the snow. And every tree was glittering, and Sugar Fork black and singing along mostly under the ice. The snow come plumb up to my knees. Nobody else had got up yet, and I reckon I was the onliest one in the world. My breath hung like clouds in the air, and the sun come up then. It like to have blinded me. Well, now, this is the time I know, Mrs. Brown, when you pray. But to answer your question, if I pray, I cannot. So I know I am evil, but I do not feel evil. And this is what happened next. I heard them guns popping all through the hills, and then I knowed it was Christmas, which I had clean forgot. All the rest of them was sleeping in the house. Ethel, I hollered, and directly she come, wearing Daddy's dead mama's old coat. She looked so funny I like to have died. Get the gun, I hollered. And whilst she was doing it, I laid right down in the snow and made angels. I must have made 1,000 angels, but I never got wet. That snow was as dry as powder. Lord, it was a pretty, pretty day. Then I stands up and brushes off Daddy's coat real good and drawed in my breath real good, and it was like I was breathing champagne. And I says, I am the Ice Queen, right out loud. I felt so good. Then Ethel come running out with the guns, and we fired them. I love that blue smoke and the way they smell. Well, this woken everybody up, of course, and they flung open the door and all come running out hollering. Even Beulah, who is big now, and little Danny, he is sick, was laughing and crying at once. And then do you know what happened next? Our mama tied back her hair and smiled and popped popcorn on the fire. Did you ever hear the like of popping corn for breakfast? It beat all. So now, that was what happened on the morning of December 25th, and next I will tell you of what followed, which is so strange I cannot credit it yet at all. It was along about evening, and Ethel and Garney and me was all gathered up close around the fire trying to get dried out. We had done gone all the way down to Home Creek and slid on the ice with the neighbor people, the Conaways and the Rolettes and the Foxes. They was all out there sliding, and Delphi Rolette, he was playing the fool. He brung a little rocky chair out there and took to pushing all the little ones on the ice. One time his old woman, Riva Rolette, come out from there, crying and twisting her hands and saying, "Oh, Delphi, come on back to the house. You know you are crazy drunk. You are going to hell for certain." But Mr. Delphi Rolette, he laughs a great big laugh and pushes little old Dreama Fox, the leastest one of them foxes, around on the ice. I've heard tell how Mr. Delphi Rolette is so bad to drink, but you cannot tell it. I think he is nice, but his old woman is touched for sure. She's crazy religious, too. Oakley Fox says she talks out of her head and will swallow her tongue if and the rest of them does not hold her down and grab it. She is a big, large, fleshy woman and real religious, so they say. And Oakley Fox is telling me all of this. Then he says, "Come up to the house now. My mama says to bring you all up there afore you set off for home." Now Oakley's mama, Edith Fox, is real slight and ashy pale. Her hair is as light as Sylvany's. "Oh, honey," she says to me, "how are you keeping?" She's not as big as a minute, Edith Fox. And then she just up and kisses me, which set me off crying. I can't say for why, though. It is like Oakley's mama is little and soft and sweet, but my mama is hard as a rocky cliff, and her eyes burns out in her head. "Looky here, young'uns," Oakley's mama says, and she given us a hunk of apple stack cake apiece. It was the bestest thing I have put in my mouth so far. And Oakley and Dreama and Ray get stack cake whenever they want it, I reckon. Their daddy lives in a camp at Coburn. He has got a big job in the lumber mills there and don't come home of a week. Ethel and me says, "No, thank you, ma'am," after one hunk. But that little old Garney just eats and eats. I don't reckon he's ever had such as that before. Dreama and Ray is spoilt, I think. But Oakley is real nice. In fact, he is too nice. I guess I'm like Daddy and hate to be beholden for airy a thing. Oakley has freckles and a big smile like his mama's. I cannot smile back. Instead, I want to hit him. I cannot tell why. so we make our manners and climb up Sugar Fork. It was coming on for dark then, and all the shadows was blue. We cross Sugar Fork 1-2 times on the crackly ice, and then we come walking up the lastest rise, me and Ethel pulling Garney by the hands atwixt us, and him just fussing. And then we can see the house sticking up there out in the snow, with smoke rising from the chimney, and snow on the roof shakes and icicles hanging down off on the roof. The cedars look so different, all bowed down with snow, and blue shadows underneath coming creeping up toward the house. Law, it looked like a picture book. "This here is Christmas," I says to Garney and Ethel. "Now you all mark it." And when we come in, my hands was too froze to work good. "Did you all have a good time?" Mama asked us, and we said, "Yes'm." Her and Beulah was carding wool by the fire, and Daddy was sound asleep on his pallet right there. You could hear his breath all around it as like a rattle way down inside him. Sylvany was looking out the window. She can look for hours and hours at the snow. It is like she's never seed any such thing. She takes on so about the snow. So I go over and look out with her. It was coming on for dark real fast then. Everything was blue and gray and white and silver. It did not look like Sugar Fork no more. It looked like fairyland out there as night come on. Then the air growed as thick and as dark as the waters of that big swimming hole down on the Lavisa River where Daddy taken us once it. And when we looked out the winder, it was like looking down in that swimming hole where we could see the forms of the silver trout fish go flashing by way down so deep in the water that you couldn't exactly see them. You just thought you could. Well, looking out the window was like that. I thought I could almost see things, or the shapes of things, moving behind the dark, behind the cold, thick air. Sylvany and me held hands. "I know I'm telling too much, Mrs. Brown. It may not be appropriate, neither. But this come next. You will not believe it." We was looking out real quiet at the snow, and Mama and Beulah was carding the wool, and Ethel and Garney asleep on the floor. You couldn't hear a thing but the crackling fire and a pop every now and then if an icicle cracked off in the roof, when all of a sudden there comes the loudest whistle you ever heard, right up close to the house. So Sylvany commences to blubbering and runs and gets down in the bed. Beulah throws down her wool and comes over there to look out. But it is dark now. You can't see nothing. Then we hear that whistle again. Real loud and real close to the house. It don't sound like anything I ever heard. It sounds like a screech owl, but it ain't a screech owl. It sounds like a shrieking haint. "Lord, Lord," my mama says. I look back at her, and in the fire's red light, she looks almost pretty. I swear her face is different all of a sudden. She touches her hair with a hand that shakes like a moth flying. Well, that set me back some, I will tell you. But then I looked over at Daddy, and Lord, it was the biggest surprise I had seen yet. Daddy sat right up in the bed and throwed Granny Rose's quilt right down on the floor and swung his legs around like he was fixing to stand up, like he was a man that could get up out in the bed. While now outside, this whistling has switched to a tune. There never was a bird that could whistle as good as that. "What is it? What is it?" axes Beulah and me. "Lord, Lord," is all Mama says. Then there comes a loud pounding on the door, and then Daddy turns and grins the biggest grin, and I recollected all of a sudden how he used to look, how he used to be such a handsome man, and what all he used to do. He keeps on grinning. "It is revel," is what he says. "Well, let him in, girls," he said then, and I run to open the door, and sure enough, it is our Uncle Revel that we have not seed for years, not since I was a little girl, and him and Daddy fell out so bad. Revel lets out a big whoop and a holler and comes right on in and gives Daddy a hug. "John Arthur," he says, and Daddy says, "Revel." Then they look at each other for a long time, and then Revel goes over and says, "Maud, how are you?" to Mama, who is trying to stay mad, but she can't do no good with that. "Well, shut the door then, Revel. You're letting out all the heat," Mama says, and he done so. And all the time, Uncle Revel's big black dog is wagging himself all over the house and licking at people and jumping up. Ethel wakes up scared to death and crying, and so does Garney. "You hush now," Mama says. "This is your Uncle Revel that you have heard tell of." And then Revel says, "Sit," to his dog, and it does. This dog is named Charlie, we come to learn. It minds the best and is the smartest of any dog I ever seed, I'll say that. Charlie goes everywhere with Uncle Revel. And now I will tell you of Uncle Revel himself and what he looks like. He wears a big black hat like a cowboy hat and black boots and a long dark coat. He has a black beard and a mustache and kind of pale silver eyes. But he is not as scary looking as this sounds. No, but Revel's eyes is just jumping, just full of fire and foolishness. When he smiles, his teeth is like a slash of white in his face. His lips is as red and full as a pretty woman's. Well, then he goes out, and then he comes back in with a poke, and then we see he's brung us jawbreaker candy from town, and even Sylvany comes creeping down out in the loft to get hern, and Uncle Revel looks at her and says, "Lovely." He has brung whiskey to drink and his banjo to play. He sings like a man on the radio. Mrs. Brown, you have never heard such like in all your life. And Daddy is setting up now, and he axes for his guitar, and Mama gets it. But he can't do nothing except just pluck at it a little bit. Mama lays it there alongside of him on his pallet by the fire. Uncle Revel sings a bunch of funny songs. Now, I have heard tell all my life how Uncle Revel cannot keep his hands off the women nor stay out in trouble. But what I think is, he is just a natural antic. He gets us all to laughing so hard we can't hardly stop. We sing, "Oh, I will go to meeting, I will go to meeting, I will go to meeting in an old tin pan." We sing, "Bile them cabbage down," and other tunes. One time Revel looks at Mama and jerks his head at me and says, "That's the one, Maud. She takes after you, she'll be trouble all right. She'll be wild as a buck like you. Just wait and see." But Mama's face turns as dark as a storm cloud and she says, "Revel, Revel, all that is past. Revel, you're crazy. You'll never grow up." "I hope not, Maud," says Revel. We sing Skip to Maloo and Sarah Jane. Daddy has fell asleep by now, and Revel gets up and gets Daddy's guitar real gentle-like and hangs it back up where it goes. He kneels down by Daddy like he is praying and touches his face. Don't nobody say a word. Then Revel stands up and puts on his hat and pulls on his gloves and tips up the bottle and drinks the rest of that whiskey down. "Oh, Charlie," he says. "Can't she stay the night, Revel?" axes Mama. But Uncle Revel says, "No, Maud, I've got to get on down the road now." And then he winks at her, and I am the onliest one besides Mama that sees it. In this wink, there is a woman someplace waiting on him, and all of a sudden Oakley Fox pops up in my mind. This makes me so mad I like to have died. Oakley Fox is stupid. He's too nice. I stomped on one foot with the other, and I was that mad. And Revel grinned at me and said, "That's the one to watch, Maud," to Mama. Then he picked me up and hugged me to him. His beard and mustache is scratchy. He smelled wonderful, like tobacco and whiskey and out of doors. "Oh, Charlie," he said. And then he was gone. So Uncle Revel has come to call on Christmas Day, I reckon, and has gone on his way again. He has given us all them jawbreaker candies and also money, Mama says. She says, "Thank God." So I am wishing you a Merry Christmas, Mrs. Brown, and Mr. Brown, too, down there. It has been a lot happening. We are fine, though, and I remain your devoted, Ivy Rowe. My dear Hanukkah, I know you will not get this letter. I know I will not send it. You are the ice queen, so cold with your icy blue eyes and your cap like a snowflake and your long white stockings as white as the snow. But it is snowing now, and so I think of you, and sometimes it seems to me like you are more real than all of my family. You seem more real to me now than the days that pass. It seems like I cannot talk to my family. There is so many of us here in this house, in the snow. We have to keep the young'uns in. You cannot bathe yourself, nor nothing. And little Danny cries. There is no place here you can go to get away from him crying. It is only when I am writing you this letter late in the night that I don't hear. And Daddy, my sweet Daddy, sleeps in the light of the fire now. He won't hardly wake up for a thing. The snow is drifting plumb up to the roof on the north side of the house, and every time you get the water from the spring, you've got to bust the ice, and then you've got to haul it through all this snow. It is so hard. We have not got but one pair of gloves amongst us. Yesterday, when I was the one hauling the water, it was coming on for dark. I slipped and fell coming down the hill and spilled my whole bucket full of water. I just laid in the snow and cried, and it was getting dark all around me. I just lay there crying while night come on. And before long, I could feel my tears freezing on my face. I was so cold, and all the air was blue. I tell you, I wanted nothing more than to lay there. That blue air seemed so pure and sweet. I could hear the wind go whoosh, real gentle-like, through the cedar tree, and come whooshing across the snow, and it was so quiet there. The wind whooshed across my face. But then Mama hollered out, "Where was I?" And the third time she hollered, I said I was coming. And I went back up there and got us some more water, and then I went on in the house. My leg had got cut and bleeding, but I never even knowed it till I seen it in the light. I would have laid there forever if I could have. Do you think this is evil? It is true, though, believe you me. Well, that was yesterday evening, and then we ate us some sweet taters Mama had roasted in the fire, and a pot of soup beans she had cooked with some fat back in them, and some cornbread Beulah made. Her cornbread is better than Mama's. So this was good. And Garney and Ethel is getting some meat back on their bones, now I'm proud to say. And Johnny, he grows like a weed, but Danny don't do no good. He carries his head to the side and walks on a slant, it seems. And then, all of a sudden, in comes Gay Nell and Virgie Klein. Never even knocked nor hollered nor nothing. Just pushed open the door and poked those old black bonnets around it. Sylvania and Beulah screamed bloody murder, and Ethel, she went for the gun. "Law, law," Mama said. But Daddy, he slept on. So the Klein sisters comes on in laughing like silver bells. Then they see Daddy and goes over there and bends way down and touches him here and there. Their hands is fluttering like butterflies down by Sugar Fork in the spring. "Oh, oh," they said, "John Arthur is going." And they touched his forehead. He stirred, but he never awoke. "He is going," they said. "Oh, la." For they had not knowed this. They never leave their cabin hardly ever, which is way away up on Hell Mountain. Daddy used to take us up there to hear their stories. Lord, you ought to see how they live. Their cabin is so little, it is like a dolly cabin, with everything just so. They is two pallets there with the prettiest quilts, and two little old rocky chairs by the fire, and two cups and two plates on the table, and two little brooms, and not a thing else. Gaynell and Virgie Klein are maiden ladies, and have not been apart for a minute. They sit on the porch in little straight-backed chairs with seats of woven hickory, smoking pipes. Their faces are little and squunched up like apple dolls. They are teeny tiny with curly white hair and don't weigh hardly a thing. Don't nobody know how they live exactly, Daddy said. They do not farm nor raise a thing but beans and flowers in the yard, nor have a cow. But folks takes them food just to hear their stories. I think myself they live on stories. They do not need much food. but I'm telling how they come in here last night and like to frighten us out in our wits. And then Sylvany, now mark you, it was Sylvany. I swear she knows more than folks think. Sylvany says, oh, it must be old Christmas. For this is when they used to come every year, January 5th, like clockwork, and stay up all night and drink coffee and tell stories with Daddy. They did it when he was not but a child, living here with his own Mama and Daddy, and his sister Vicey, and brother Revel. Daddy always said it seemed to him that they were old ladies then, so don't nobody know how old they might be now. So Gaynell and Virgie Klein were talking back and forth amongst themselves and looking at Daddy. Their talking was too soft to hear good, and it sounded like another language almost, like bells in the snow. You could tell they didn't know if and twould be better to stay nor go. Danny and Johnny was holding on to Ethel's legs and peeping out in her skirts with their eyes as big as a plate. And you could hear our Daddy drawing every breath. I looked at Mama, which weren't no good. Mama was looking wild, and she bit at her lip. She had bit it so much it was already bleeding. Her hair was all over her head. She clutched up her skirt in her hands. And all I could think of, I swear, was that snow outside, I swear, where I had laid, as I said, for upwards of an hour, and where it was so quiet and peaceful. Lord, it was like it drawed me out the door almost. It was like I was being pulled. But then all of a sudden I heard myself say, and it was me, mind you, I was the one that said it, well, now you've come so far, we hope you will stay. Take off your bonnets, come close to the fire, and tell us a story. For it seemed to me that the only way I could keep from running back out in the snow was to hear a story. Mama looked ill as a hornet at me, but then she looked down at Daddy, and then she told Beulah to make some coffee, which Mrs. Brown had sent us up here by Green Patterson. And the lady sat down by the fire, and we all gathered up around. Don't tell Bloody Bones, begged Beulah, whatever you do. And just the mention of it set Sylvany off. I had to wet her face down to make her hush. Tell old Dry Fry, I said. This one is funny, and Daddy's favorite. Well, old Dry Fry was a preacher man, one of the ladies started. But you can't tell Gaynell from Virgie. It's not worth your trouble to try. And when they tell a story, it goes back and forth, first one to the other, you know. She said, everybody knowed old Dry Fry. And old Dry Fry liked to eat so much, he would eat at two or three houses sometimes after meeting. And one time, when he was eating, he ate so much that he up and died. Well, in the house where he died lived a man named Ray Doolittle, and he said, law me, we will be hung for murder. And so he wrapped old Dry Fry up in a quilt and taken him down the road and leaned him up again another feller's door. And when this other feller's old woman opened the door that following day, why, old Dry Fry fell in the house, and everybody said, law me, it's old Dry Fry dead. We will be hung for murder. For everybody knowed old Dry Fry. So they put him in a corn crib, and then they taken him out in the dead of night and set him up in the brush by the high road. And directly a rich man come along, and some highway robbers come up and shot at him until they had cotched him and took all his money, and then they let him go. This rich man's name was old Moneybags McIntosh, and he run off crying to beat the band. Then it got full light. And them highway robbers seed old Dry Fry setting up there dead in the brush by the side of the road, and they said, law me, it's old Dry Fry dead as a post. We will be hung for murder. For everybody knowed old Dry Fry. So they taken old Fry down to the river bank and propped him up by a willow tree, and he stayed right there until a little old feisty boy come along and said, ho there, old Dry Fry. For everybody knowed old Dry Fry. And when old Dry Fry didn't say nothing, this little feisty boy said, I reckon you think you are too good to talk, old Dry Fry. And when old Dry Fry didn't say nothing then, why, this little feisty boy just poked him in the river with a willow stick and run off down the road. Now there was an old woman down there fishing for bass fish, and Lord, she cotched old Dry Fry, and she said, "Law me! Here is old Dry Fry as dead as a stone. I will be hung for murder." For everybody knowed old Dry Fry. And the sisters passed the story around back and forth between them, and by we was all laughing and laughing, even Serious Ethel and gloomy little old Garney and even Mama. Well, she was not laughing, but she had sat down there by Daddy and she had left off clutching her skirt. There is something very funny about saying old Dry Fry over and over. So the story goes on. It goes back and forth betwixt Gaynell and Virgie Klein, until at the end of it, we was doubled up laughing, and old Dry Fry had been put in a poke and tied onto a horse, and the last anybody knowed, the horse was galloping off for Kentucky under the light of the moon. And then they told a bunch more, including Mutz Mag, which Sylvanie asked for. Now you see how good she can recollect. So the sisters told Mutz Mag, which is about an old woman that had three gals, Paul, Betts, and Mutz Mag. But they all treated Mutz Mag mean. She had to do all the work while they'd lay in bed of a morning and not give her nothing to eat but leftovers and old sour milk. Then the old woman up and died, and the girls had to go in the world to seek their fortune, and they said, "Mutz Mag, you come too." But she had to carry all their plunder, and they wouldn't give her no journey cakes. But after many adventures, a giant comes along, and he eats up Paul and Betts, and then he turns into a handsome prince and took Mutz Mag off to a faraway country where she was the queen. I loved that one. But now it was late, and the Litlands had fell asleep, and even Ethel was fixing to fall asleep. You could tell by her eyes drooping down. The Klein sisters stirred and rustled as if they was fixing to go. Me and Sylvanie was the onliest one still up and listening. And I recollect how, if Daddy had not been so sick, he would have been telling, too. He loved the old stories so. And I recollected what all he used to say about old Christmas Eve. How alder buds will bust and leaf out, and bees will roar in a bee gum like they're fixin' to swarm, and briars will blossom and animals will speak, and if you go up on a real high hill, you might see a big star rise. Daddy always said old Christmas was a time to stay home and think on what will last. And what will last? I said to myself right then. And I looked over at Daddy there fixing to die, and the fire was dying too. It was real late, but I wasn't one bit sleepy. "Nothing lasts," I said to myself. "Nothing, not nary a thing." And then the sisters, who had been stirring to go, sat back and said, "Well now, Ivy, this one is for you." And they told it then in a whisper so low, it was like it was told in my very own head. There was a man with three daughters who was fixing to go to town, and he asked, "What do you want me to bring you girls?" For he loved them very much. The eldest one asked for a new silk dress the color of every bird in the sky, and the second eldest asked for a new silk dress the color of every color in the rainbow. And the youngest, who was the father's favorite, asked for white roses. Well, the onliest white roses in the whole town was on a rosy bush in the churchyard, and when the father commenced to break these roses, he heard a voice that said, "You break them, and I will break you." And then he commenced to break them again, and then he heard it again. And then he thought about his youngest daughter and how bad she wanted them white roses. But then finally he heard the voice say, "Give me what meets you first at the gate. You can break all you want till your basket is full." And he thought of his old hound dog that allus run out to the gate, and he said that would be all right. But when he rode up carrying his roses, who should run out but his youngest girl? She said, "Daddy, Daddy." "Get back, sugar," he hollered. but she come on anyways and give him a big kiss and took the roses. So the father was trouble, but he didn't say nothing nor tell it. And then as soon as dark come, they heard a big voice say, "Send out my pay." So the father, he tried to send out the old hound dog, but the voice come again, "Send out my pay." So the father, he went out there hisself, and then the eldest girl, she went. But the voice come again, "Send out my pay." And finally, the youngest girl, she give them all a kiss and gotten her bonnet and coat and gone out the door, where she was surprised to find the biggest white bear she had ever seed, who said, "Get up on my back." And she done it. But she was crying so hard that her nose bled, and 3 drops of blood fell on the white bear's back. But he kept running on and on. And finally he come to a nice cabin and lit the lamp, and lo and behold, he was a good-looking young feller, and as soon as she seed him, she thought the world of him. But now she had to choose. He said his name was White Bear Whittington, and he had been witched so that he could be a man of a night and a bear of a day, or a bear of a night and a man of a day. "Now which will it be?" asked White Bear Whittington. She picked a man of a night. So in the daytime he'd be a bear and lay around in the woods outside whilst she kept house, and then come night and he'd be a man, and she was as happy as she could be, for she loved him with all her heart. She had 3 babies, and time passed, and she wanted to show them to her daddy. She knowed he was getting old. "Well, you can do this," said White Bear Whittington, "but don't you never speak my name, no matter what you do." And she said she would never do so. So he took them on his back next morning to her father's gate. "Now I am so happy to see you, honey," her father said. But he kept on asking who was these babies. And finally, because she loved him so, she said, "White Bear Whittington." Well, Lord, then it lightninged and thunder rolled, and when she raised up her eyes, she seed her husband going up Pine Mountain, and on the back of his shirt was 3 drops of blood. Oh, how she hollered and cried then, for she loved him. So she left her children with her father and set out after him, and she walked the mountains for 7 long years, and whenever she lost heart, a white bird would fly over and drop a feather with a red speck on it, so she would keep on going. And sometimes she would come to a house where they'd tell her about a fine young man who had been there only the night before, with 3 drops of blood on the back of his shirt. And she kept walking for 7 years. She would have give up if she had not come upon a old woman who gave her 3 gold nuts, a walnut and a hickory nut and a chinky pin, and said for her to follow the river and she would find her man. So she done so. But what she found was a bunch of women washing his shirt, for whoever could get out the blood could have him. So she grabbed it away from them women, and in a minute it come clean. But then another woman jerked it away, and so this other woman got him and took him home. And all this time he never knowed her. He looked her straight in the eye and never knowed her. So the girl gave the woman her gold chinky pin just to sleep with him one night. And so she did. And in the night the girl said, "Three drops of blood I've shed for thee. 3 little babes I've borne for thee. White Bear Whittington, turn to me." But the old lady had done give him a sleepy dram, and he would not wake. And then the girl give the woman her gold hickory nut so she could sleep with him the next night, but the same thing happened, and he slept on, and she could not rouse him. Finally, she gave the old woman her gold walnut, and it was all she had, and this evening her husband spit out his sleepy dram and did not swallow it. So when the girl said, "3 drops of blood I've shed for thee, 3 little babes I've borne for thee, White Bear Whittington, turn to me," he done so. And when she said his name, he waked up, and he knowed her. And the next morning, that old woman found the door locked as tight as a drum, and she couldn't get in no way, and she was mad as fire, but there wasn't nothing she could do, as the spell was finally broke. And they walked back over the mountains together and got their three children and went on home. And White Bear Whittington never was a bear again. I think this is the bestest story I've ever heard. By the time the sisters had quit telling it, it was real late, and everybody but me and Sylvanie was sleeping. So we helped the sisters get their bonnets and their coats where we had hanged them up to dry, and they said over and over they had to go. They would not spend the night, which we knowed anyway. They never will stay the night, but walk in all weathers home. Goodbye, then, we said. We could not see their faces under their bonnets, nor hear what they said, which sounded like fairy bells in the snow. When they tell a story, you can hear them. Sylvanie stood in the door and watched them go, and I come and stood in the door behind her. And Mama raised up and hollered at us for letting out heat. So we went out and closed the door behind us and stood barefoot in the snow. It was not even cold a bit, watching the lady sisters skitter like water bugs over the snow, moving faster and faster, it seemed, until they were lost in the shadows of trees as they headed up Hell Mountain so fast it seemed they were flying. Sylvanie and me stood with our arms around each other's waists and looked at everything. The moon on the snow so bright it was almost like day, the snow shining back at the moon. The sisters disappeared. But when I was straining to see them, I seed something else, and I will swear it. You could see in that moonlight as plain as day, and what I seed was White Bear Whittington walking into the dark trees and them three drops of blood on his back. I grabbed Sylvanie hard. It made her laugh out loud. She thought I was funning her, and then she couldn't stop laughing. It took a while. I said, "Sylvanie, Sylvanie, did you see him?" And she said, "Who?" But Sylvanie don't know what she sees. And I seed him myself, I tell you. Seed his white shirt and fine gold hair all shining. White Bear Whittington, I seed him as plain as day. But I can't tell it to nobody else, so I have writ it down for you, cold Hanukkah, Hanukkah Queen, or for nobody.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.